Thank you for coming. We have a full program now with four speakers. It's a great pleasure to bring them together from three or four disciplines. It's hard to say. We've got at least two lawyers here, but one from a civil law background, more civil law, one from common law background. We have a medical doctor, and we have a psychologist, a psychoanalyst. So we're going to have a number of perspectives on our topic to share today. This session is being streamed and recorded. So if you miss something or want to hear it again, you can check later. We'll give you the link for follow-up. We're going to go in the order that appears in the program. We'll start with the scholar at risk here at the University of Ottawa, Mr. Hossein Raeesi. I should just say a word about the scholar at risk program. This is a program that goes back with a significant history to the interwar, the pre-Second World War period, when natural scientists in the United Kingdom provided refuge in the sense of scholarly community to persons from then Nazi Germany who were being denied the ability to continue their scholarly work. And of course, then much worse followed. And specifically, Professor Rutherford at Cambridge University offered the opportunity to Albert Einstein of a scholarly community, and Albert Einstein went to Cambridge and then went to Princeton, famously, afterwards. But they decided to start a system of basically community support among scholars for other scholars at that time. That has now expanded to many, many countries of the world, and some years ago in the early 1990s in the United States of America, another kind of sister program was developed called Scholars at Risk Network, which has now almost 400 universities and academic institutions associated with it across North America. It was started out of University of Chicago, now run out of New York University. And there are 13 academic institutions in Canada that provide a scholar refugee a community. And we, together with Carleton University, began this year our first involvement, and Hossein Raeesi is our first scholar at risk. He's a practicing lawyer from Iran, where he specialized in the defense of human rights and specifically against major crimes, in particular capital crimes. He's represented a number of persons who were subject to the death penalty, unfortunately, who suffered the death penalty, but also a range of other persons, for example, LGBTQ persons in defense of their rights and so forth. And some years ago, under pressure from the government of Iran, to reduce or stop his own practice and risking to become prosecuted himself, he came to Canada. The last thing I'll just say is that 2 weeks ago, Hossein became a Canadian. So Hossein's going to recount a few of his views on this specific subject, and then we'll proceed to the next persons in order. Hossein, please.
Thank you, John. Thank you, everybody, to inviting me and coming here. I'm going to say a little bit about my background and also refugees' rights. I'm going to focus on rights, not needs. I was under huge pressure when I left Iran in 2012. Every morning, I was waiting till some officer came to my home and arrested me. I was under huge pressure because I was under interrogation from the officer of intelligence service of Iran because of my practice, because of my method practice of human rights. When I was in Iran, I support Afghan refugee in Iran. I had a 12 years girl, a refugee client that she raped in Iran. I never forgot her face. I asked some of my friends, he was doctor, psychiatrist, to voluntarily support her. And I won her case in the Supreme Court of Iran. But the refugees, it's the consequence of the civil war, consequence of dictatorship and consequence of the failure of the world to keep peace for people around the world. Based on this, I'm going to draw your attention to this. Refugees don't need, they have rights to get our support, get our protection. They have rights. They rights to be safe. The alliance of countries who are working on Syrian, they have responsibility to keep children, women, all people, civilian people in the Syrian, keep safe. Based on this, they have rights to get support. They have rights to be safe. And huge pressure of them, they're gonna lead them to be a part, to be an illness, mental illness, and also to join a terrorist group, to join groups who have violence, attacked, and also the base of this is their rights to get the support. And unfortunately, we should ask ourselves, 10,000 children, Syrian children, who lost so far in European Union, where are they? And if we never care about them, they're going to be under huge pressure, and they're going to be a mental disorder and join the violence groups. Thank you for coming here and attention this very important area of the refugees, and thank you for all support of the refugees and not support because they are need. No, they have rights. Thank you.
Thanks, Hossein. So our next speaker is Professor Renos Papadopoulos. Professor Papadopoulos is a psychologist and a leading Jungian psychoanalyst. For anyone who has time to go through, he is the author of a 1,750-page tome, I think it's three volumes, if I'm not mistaken, on Carl Gustav Jung. So he's a major scholar in the field, but he, many years ago, focused his practice specifically on refugees and established a unique and world-leading program at the University of Essex. It's a clinical program with the Tavistock Clinic in London for refugee care for at the master's and doctoral level. And each year he's now been, for many years, I don't know how many years, you'll tell us, Renos, been supervising a large number of doctoral students, about 16, a cohort of 16 master's students each year, from a mix of backgrounds, a number of whom are actually practitioners who come together to follow his clinical program. He's become an advisor to many governments and international organizations. In the last number of months, he's been shuttling back and forth between Turkey, Greece, Cyprus, and elsewhere, dealing with the communities and the of reception, but also the refugees themselves. I know from his background that he's advised many years in mass refugee flow and mass refugee sites, for example, the world's largest refugee camps in Kenya, Somalia, elsewhere, dealing with mass psychoses and all of the challenges of the affected populations, both the migrant or refugee population, the receiving communities, and also caregivers. Without further ado, I'd like to ask Professor Papadopoulos, he'll present for us an overview of his approach and also what he's been treating.
Thank you very much, John. Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me here. It's wonderful to reconnect with my good friend and colleague, Professor Parker, and it's wonderful to meet all of you here. In the brief time that I have to share with you some thoughts and ideas, I've selected some key points, and I look forward to some discussion later. But when we're talking about the mental health perspective of refugees in general, refugee crisis right now, let's not forget that right now, as we're talking about these issues, the borders of Syria and Turkey are crowded with people trying to enter Turkey. And this is just clearly is not humanitarian, is not mental health, is not anything else. It's simply a political issue between Turkey and other countries as to whether Turkey accepts that or not. And this is the interesting and the complexity about these issues, because we can look at this phenomenon from so many different perspectives, but at the bottom of it, essentially, it's a political issue. Without going into great details, we can be reminded of the very recent statistics that tell us a lot. These are actually statistics from UNHCR from last week. And we can see, perhaps the slide may not be very clear, but you can see the graph here that you would have thought that the influx of refugees from Turkey to the Greek islands, that then they come to the mainland of Greece and then they come into Europe, would have slowed down during the, and all of us expected that, during the colder months of autumn, fall. You call it fall here, don't you? Yes, yes. During fall here and winter, yet it peaked actually in October and November. I was there, and it was just unbelievable. In some little islands, you would get something like 600-800 refugees arriving per day. So the world has been flooded by the images of these refugees, and this is what you see in the media, the pain and the ecstasy of people arriving and the chaos, and of course some iconic issues like Aylan Kurdi, who has been used by many people as a an icon of what has happened there. And this is a very interesting cartoon that shows Aylan on drowned on the one side, whereas other children are building Fortress Europe. But it has been used widely in protests. And honestly, when I took this photograph myself of a young refugee who just arrived on the island of Chios, that was, I think that was October or November, I don't remember exactly, I didn't realize that actually he was wearing the, shall we say, the uniform. I didn't realize that the red T-shirt and the jeans has become iconic. But my point is, all of us know about Alan, but do we know about this young man and what he is thinking of having just arrived in this place? And there are thousands, and there are nearly a million people like him, anonymous, sitting there trying to piece together what has happened to him. And then we are just wondering, from which perspective can we approach a person like that? Here is another little girl that is trying to literally piece together a puzzle that was on the island of Kos in November. It was a very cold evening, and there are hundreds of people around, and this little girl, that's the belongings of her family. That's all they came with. She's just sitting there. The Red Cross gave them little toys, and she picked up the puzzle, and she's trying to puzzle out something. I hope she finds something for all of us, because we're all lost with these, what I would call, orange stigmata on our conscience. They are all scattered all over the Greek islands. By the way, you may know that most of them are fake. They are actually not life-saving jackets. They are stuffed with newspapers. So the traffickers are not only benefiting from extraordinary fees, but also they're giving them fake life jackets, the majority of them. But, of course, another issue is that they are creating an environmental hazard. So the question is, therefore, if we are scientists and we're trying to address the phenomenon, what is the phenomenon? What is the phenomenon? Is the phenomenon the traumatized refugees, or the burnout workers, or the organizations involved, or the affected local population, or the affected population of the countries of origin, or the affected population of the countries of destination, or the way the entirety of the associated phenomena is presented and represented by the media, politicians, professionals, and affected persons. So in a sense, the first question is, what grip do we get on this situation, on this phenomenon, from which perspective? Because all of these things are so closely interlinked, and the phenomenon is so highly complex. And it's not only complex, this phenomenon, just to be reminded of all of these dimensions, psychological, psychosocial, psychiatric, human rights, political, military, security, medical, social, economic, environmental, spiritual, just the list is endless. Not only is this phenomenon very complex, but when we're looking at the changes, what kind of changes are we looking at? We're looking at the external visible changes. People lost homes, people lost jobs, people lost members of their families, but also there are the internal changes, invisible changes, emotional, psychological, as we may call them. But also in addition, and I'm very interested in the third category that usually we don't even think of because we think either of the external or the internal, is what I would call epistemological changes. In other words, how do we conceptualize this phenomenon? What are the different ways of viewing these experiences? How do we construe them, us, others, on a personal level, family level, community level, different cultural levels? Because I think there is a lot that is lost in the misunderstanding of these different epistemological conceptualizations of what the very phenomenon is. So therefore, all of this thing really is overwhelming. The totality of all of these things, unmistakably, is overwhelming. The problem is enormous, is immense. The scale and depth of human suffering, the inhumanity of certain actions. I would also add the humanity and the incredible altruism that we see in situations in these circumstances, equally overwhelming. And it evokes strong emotional reactions, indignation, anger, compassion, sympathy, as well as an impulse for action, for any action. Always we sort of feel, for God's sake, we need to do something. We can't just sit there. And this overwhelmingness of the phenomenon creates a painful pressure on everybody, with, psychologists would say, creates no space for us to think, to reflect, to conceptualize in a clearer way. So we're almost driven by this or the other discourse to conceptualize these phenomena in a certain way. So if we can put it a little bit schematically, graphically, we would sort of show this overwhelming amorphous cloud oppressing us, that once we're under that influence, we tend, because we need to grasp things, and we tend to very oversimplify phenomena. Lack of complexity is, for me, the first casualty of these situations. Lack of complexity. And that leads often to polarization, and the polarization is at all levels. Us are good and them is bad. Us are healthy and them are traumatized. Us, there are some good refugees and bad migrants. That's a very common one, very common one. Good refugees and bad migrants. We should give asylum to all, or we should reject everybody. Another sharp polarization. We can help and be effective, or we can't help and we're useless. Another polarization. And the essence of the two discourses, of the two debates, one based on compassion exclusively, and the other based on fear exclusively. So we see that the very conceptualization of the phenomenon is sharply polarized. And therefore, we are asking ourselves how to conceptualize this phenomena in a better way. And how do we usually deal with the rational and things that are beyond our usual understanding? Usually, art, literature, film, dance, songs. How much is that from the refugee community? If we see them exclusively as traumatized or as subjects of our protests and all of that, where is the creativity that actually they can convey the pain, the disorientation, the suffering, as well as the hope that these situations usually engender? And this is, for me, missing in this sharply polarized debate. So I would argue, I'm sort of making a strong point here intentionally, that the traditional distinction between refugees and migrants is no longer viable, and if anything, I would argue that it is dangerous. Because in effect, both of these people need to abandon their countries as conditions are no longer viable for them to make a living in a dignified way due to a variety of factors, including political. So the political dimension is there, even in the so-called economic migrants. And the argument that we accept bona fide refugees but not economic migrants, I don't think any longer is viable. A key consideration that the first speaker has already made is something for me very important. We have created, we have gradually developed a discourse that we want to help these poor people out of pity because they are traumatized. And we are flooded with these images of women screaming and pitiful scenes of human suffering. No, it was said very clearly. These people are entitled to protection and to rights. We should not help them because they are traumatized. If they are traumatized or not, that's another story. It should be another story. It should not be the main card that we should be using in order to develop our argument. And unfortunately, our world has moved into that skewed perspective, where what we're, in order to solicit any help, in order to argue for the basic dignity or human dignity and human rights, we're talking about them being traumatized, regardless of whether they are or not. That's, for me, a different issue, and it should be a different issue. And I'm sure that that's not what you expected from a psychologist. So if we were really going to ask about, you know, what is the nature then of their affliction? Yeah, we're talking about an affliction. Is it really mental illness? Is that the best way to describe it? And I'm not saying, I keep repeating, I'm not saying that some people do not suffer from some mental illness. Although, if we were to really scrutinize the literature and the studies properly, not journalistically, we will see that the people who actually suffer from mental illness, in other words, psychiatric disorders, are people who have already had previously experienced mental disorders. These kind of situations create an intense human suffering, and this is the key thing, that our society has no space for that human suffering, and we need to call it with some psychiatric label. And for me, there is a problem, a serious problem there. So we don't make a distinction between a distress and a disorder. And we need to shove everything under the category of a disorder in order for us to become sensitive to that. In effect, we're talking about ontological, existential. The very fabric of their being has been shaken by these situations. Their identity, their beliefs, their trust. Is that just simply psychological or psychiatric or mental health? But we don't have a category for that. That's the difficulty. And it seems to me, and I would argue strongly, that following the path of identifying them as mental illness, we're actually committing another serious error. We're pathologizing those people that we want to help, and we were sticking a label that stays with them in a detrimental way for the future. So the challenge is for us to find a unique way of understanding this genuine distress and this genuine upheaval in their ontoecological settledness, one may call it, their disorientation. So this disorientation is not just simply psychological or psychiatric, but we can say it's spiritual, economic, medical, educational, ideological, social, and all of these things. So in effect, we're talking about a depathologization of human suffering, and that has been a kind of an agenda for a long time, and it seems we haven't really succeeded properly in depathologizing human suffering. In other words, understanding human suffering for what it is without needing to stick a psychiatric label on it. And a corollary of that is that we should also develop a sensitivity for depathologizing human compassion. It's the only way that we can help people, offering them psychotherapy and counseling or drugs. Certainly not. And this is really the challenge that we need to face. So one follows the other. What is the affliction, and what is the way that we can deal with that affliction? So as we know, that there is a very wide range of factors that affect each person, each family, each community, the way that they experience and they respond to adversity. And here are some, this is not necessarily a complete list, this is my own list, you can improve on that, but essentially, you know, I divide it into personal factors, into relational factors, into gender factors, power position, circumstances of the actual devastating events, meaning given to events and experiences. For example, nobody will disagree that the late President Nelson Mandela spending 27 years in prison, it was a horrific event. But was he damaged by that? Or was he strengthened by that, and his political identity developed even further? And we need to find some kind of subtlety of differentiating between the event, the nature of the event that can be condemnable, and the complexity of the effects that can include even positive ones. And we don't have that kind of epistemological agility to do that. Because if something is negative, we'll just go down the negative route of condemning everything connected with that. And that is lack of epistemological ability, agility, and that is another symptom of what I was talking about earlier about the polarization and oversimplification. In order to counteract that, the schema that I developed many years ago is this grid that is a framework that helps us understand the wide range of responses to adversity. Very briefly to take you through this, we have basically three columns. Let's stay with the negative column first. Yes, indeed, there are negative responses to adversity, but even there, we can distinguish different levels of severity. On the left, you have the most severe forms, which is psychiatric disorder, often is PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, but also there are other psychiatric disorders. Then you have other in the middle, is a category that I call distressful psychological reactions, which is a lot of different psychological symptoms that do not add up to a psychiatric diagnosis, as well as ordinary human suffering. In other words, suffering to extraordinary inhuman situations, but a kind of an ordinary response to abnormal circumstances. Next to that is another column, that is resilience. Now, I know that there are many definitions of resilience. I use a very simple and operational one. Those good qualities that people had previous to before their exposure to adversity, and they were able to retain despite their exposure to adversity. So, if we're talking about that, every human being who has survived whatever forms of adversity still retains some strengths. Do we have perspectives that can identify these and make use of them, or we just shove them all into the left column? Negative, 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 and nothing else. And then something else, if you go to the right column, which is the positive responses to adversity, and yes, there are, in all cultures, in all languages, there are expressions such as whatever doesn't kill you strengthens you, and that's a reality, and we need to include it in the way we conceptualize this phenomena. People often get a lot out of these situations. Again, be careful of the lack of epistemological agility. You say, what can you gain by losing everything? What are you talking about? Are you crazy? Well, people from these upheavals, because they have come close to death, they tell you, if we listen to them and we don't look only for their trauma and nothing else, they will tell you that actually they are looking at life in a new way. Because I've come so close to death, I look at my own previous values, and perhaps I don't want to waste my life anymore just making money and neglecting my family or things like that. So there are a lot of things that I call adversity-activated development, development that has been exclusively activated because of their exposure to adversity, and we should not forget that. Once we have that, then you have a three-dimensional way of looking at human beings, and not just simply as caricatures, negative, negative, negative effects, trauma, 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 and nothing else. And why? Because it's to do with the identities that are developed following these kind of categorizations. Usually we have stable and dynamic identities that change according to situations and circumstances. But under conditions of immense adversity, there is some sort of confusion about that. And what happens is that there is a tendency to create a fixed and static and rigid identities. And often the identities that people acquire in these situations is the victim identity. And the victim identity, it's a very dreadful consequence of these situations. And I make a very sharp distinction between people indeed being victims of circumstances as opposed to developing a victim identity. And it's, again, very fine way of distinguishing this. And we need to have that fine distinction. Otherwise, we look at them as victims, period, and they under the general identity of victims, they develop learned helplessness, they are passive, they feel entitled to everything, they don't take any responsibility. We should be very careful that there are a lot of negative effects of the victim identity. And it requires a lot of agility to see people as victims of circumstances, but not as victims. Yes, I'm a victim of earthquake, I'm a victim of this dictator, but I'm not a victim. Take some. Finally, I want to remind you that our usual way of looking at things doesn't address the complexities of these situations. For example, to begin with, refugees move from their home of origin with an intended destination, and that's all that there is in their mind. The home of origin is untenable, and the wonderful place that they are going to go is the intended destination. Along the way, what they see, what they do, is that there is, you know, the journey, the risks, and then this middle reality begins to grow, and it gets darker. And there are risks, there are dangers, there is uncertainty, there is disappointment, it's getting darker and darker and bigger, and there is despair, there is irritability, there is boredom, there is loss of direction, and they are lost. Nobody has bargained, nobody has conceptualized this huge chapter in between. They are thinking of the top, of the beginning and of the end. What about the middle? We don't think about that often either. And this is what we need to have increasingly more agile epistemological sensitivities to discern the uniqueness of their situation. Because once they lose direction, they don't know how to deal with that. It's not just simply mental illness, but you know, they lose their coping mechanisms, their basic values, their Weltanschauung, loss of their identity, they develop a victim identity, and all of these difficult, different situations. So essentially what I'm arguing for is for us to contribute, each one of us in our own modest way, towards changing the refugee discourse, the current refugee discourse that today is dominated by the trauma of them, burnout of us, the spectacle of media, of pity in the media, asylum politics, security economics, oversimplification, polarization, blame, impulsive conceptualization and action, and instead we need to develop new and creative ways of assisting complexities, bearing painful realities, compassion and dignity, thoughtful planning, collaboration and coordination. And once we begin to develop this, we can actually perhaps understand a little bit better the unique and individual predicaments that people find themselves. I'm ending with this graffiti, which was on the island of Kos, which speaks for itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Papadopoulos. So from that very large framework, we're going to come to Ottawa. And we have with us Dr. Doug Gruner. He's a practicing physician and practices right locally here in nearby hospital of Bruyere. And he's also a founder of the Canadian Doctors for Refugee Care, which attained a lot of public attention and was very successful in countering the oversimplification of our own government under the last regime, if I dare call it that, which had caused a lot of harm in terms of removing medical and other assistance for refugee claimants who are here within our country, notwithstanding our international obligations and so forth. a campaign which Doctors for Refugee Care succeeded in, with some assistance of people here at the University of Ottawa, I'm pleased to say. Dr. Gruner.
Thank you. Okay, is this on? Okay, everyone can hear me now, I think. Perfect. Thank you very much for that enlightening discussion about reframing our approach to the refugee discourse. I think that's a really excellent way of looking at this, because much too often we're coming from a very specific viewpoint, and we need to kind of broaden our perspective. So thank you very much for that. So, oops, this way. I think I pressed the wrong button.
Left.
That goes down. Okay. So, as we've all heard, the crisis in Syria and the region has reached epic proportions, with over 8 million internally displaced individuals and 4.5 million refugees, primarily living in Jordan, Lebanon, and Turkey. Here in Canada, we're stepping up in a small but significant way to take in about 25,000 Syrian refugees as permanent residents to our country. Typically, Canada brings in approximately 300,000 immigrants every year. About 10% are refugees, or 30,000. So in effect, we're doubling our intake of refugees this year. Refugee 613 is a grassroots organization that has been tasked to coordinate the resettlement of Syrian refugees here in Ottawa, along with housing, education, employment. Access to health care is key to their successful resettlement. Despite the barriers, our goal is to ensure timely access to health care, and due to the rate at which the refugees are arriving, this is posing significant challenges for us. However, for months prior to their arrival, we have been ramping up our existing systems and structures. To put this effort in context, let me outline what the Ottawa settlement community typically responds to in a given year. Generally, about 500 government-assisted refugees come through Reception House, which is a temporary lodging site, every year. Another 400 privately sponsored refugees make Ottawa their home, and approximately 800 to 900 refugee claimants as well. But now, on top of this usual flow, we are in the midst of receiving another 1,200 to 1,500 Syrian refugees. So when all is said and done, we will have received close to twice our usual numbers, if not more. In a mere 10 weeks, we have received 1,024 Syrian refugees to Ottawa. That's as of February 8th. 820 are government assisted. And again, that's almost double what we usually see in the entire year. Reception House, which has a capacity of 90 to 100 clients, has been full for weeks. So there's been three hotels that have stepped up to provide housing. The Radisson Hotel has over 200 refugees, the Embassy Suites 120, and the Travel Lodge is at about 75. Finding permanent housing, getting their children into school, learning a new language, and finding work are the main priorities for most refugees, and Syrians are no exception. Generally, refugees do not rank accessing healthcare as a high priority, unless, of course, they're sick. What we understood from the various reports coming out of Europe and from our federal government was the vast majority of the Syrian refugees were quite healthy from a physical perspective, and that mental health was likely going to be the biggest concern. What we're seeing here in Ottawa and across the country is quite different. We are seeing children with significant viral infections, including influenza A. Several had to be admitted to our Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario into the intensive care unit just this past week. We are seeing children with congenital heart conditions, others with significant cognitive delays, including cerebral palsy, Down syndrome, and other genetic disorders. We're seeing refugees that have acute care needs on arrival. So we're busy. Our initial plan at the Health Task Force was to set up two committees, one for primary care and one for mental health. The primary care team organized themselves to set up health assessment hubs across the city, whereby healthcare providers would use the evidence-based screening guidelines and templates created here in Ottawa to identify those with higher needs requiring access to the system urgently. Well, our plans quickly changed once we began receiving large numbers, between 50 to 80 primarily government-assisted refugees per day. So instead of refugees coming to our hubs, we went to see them at the hotels. So try to imagine turning a small hotel room into a triage and clinic room with cultural interpretation being provided in such a confined space. It's challenging, to say the least. As for mental illness, we need to be on the alert and highly vigilant for the early signs. However, the evidence suggests that we should not be screening for post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, and other mental health concerns in otherwise asymptomatic individuals for a number of reasons. For one, bringing this up can cause harm, especially if the individual is not ready to discuss these issues. Two, it is crucial to ensure you have adequate resources in place to deal with the issue once identified, including Arabic-speaking counselors and therapists, or cultural interpretation resources. Access to mental health in this country has been very challenging for some time, to say the least. So how will our system be able to respond with so many vulnerable and at risk coming to our city? In effect, this crisis, if you will, provides us an opportunity to rethink how we deliver services in our community. For most refugees, there is a honeymoon period when they first arrive. With so many pressing issues to deal with in what seems like a short period of time, many simply push the mental anguish to the sidelines. Until one day, when the dust settles, the kids are all in school, housing has been dealt with, and the many other initial challenges are out of the way, the horrors of what they've experienced begin to surface. This is often when we see refugees presenting in crisis, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months down the road. The levels of complexity are huge, including cultural differences, language barriers, and the stigma of mental health. I believe the best way to illustrate the challenges we face as a community in addressing mental health in our refugee population is to tell you a story. This happened just last month, of one man's mental health crisis. In the interest of confidentiality, I will just simply say he is from the Middle East and a recent arrival. As part of our outreach, our community service learning at the University of Ottawa, medical students do 30 hours of community service. There are many options to choose from, and refugee health is one. Two of our students, along with a cultural interpreter, went to see this gentleman and his family in their home. In discussing some of the migration story, it came up that he was depressed. So much so that he was thinking of suicide. There had already been one suicide attempt in the recent past. As the discussion moved towards this topic, he asked his wife to leave and take the children to their rooms. He refused to discuss this in front of her and the children. This was clearly beyond the scope of the students, who wisely called me to intervene. Over the phone and through the interpreter, I struggled to understand the situation better. I learned that he had suffered from depression for close to 10 years in his home country, that he received little to no medical care for this, that he would never see a psychiatrist, ever, because seeing a psychiatrist implied he was a crazy man. He could not talk to his wife because he did not want to upset her. He was suspicious of those in his own community. He did not trust them, and he felt judged by them. So can you imagine? He was truly alone, with no real options, in a foreign land, with limited to no English or French, Hearing more, I asked our interpreter to assess his willingness to go to the hospital. Initially, he categorically refused to entertain this idea, and again was adamant he would never see a psychiatrist. He'd rather die. But I knew it was essential to have him assessed and treated because he had a plan. He was going to kill himself. Our interpreter was an international medical graduate and had excellent communication skills. She was instrumental in gaining his trust. He agreed to go to the hospital on the condition that he would not be admitted. His settlement worker, who was involved, agreed to meet our students at the hospital, and she actually stayed overnight with him. The doctors saw him and did start medication to help with his sleep, which was a significant factor in his depression. He agreed to see a psychiatrist and in the end did have some follow-up arranged. Interestingly, he was very suspicious of the male interpreters and did not trust that they were actually relaying the information correctly to the physicians. He did not like the way they looked at him. So he asked for the female interpreter he initially put his trust in. He's not out of the woods by any stretch, but this is an example of... this is an example of how our system can work, how a system can adapt to cultural differences. It very much needs improvement. It needs resources to ensure that those improvements happen. But what I see from our mental health colleagues here is an unbelievable willingness to get this right, a willingness to work with the primary care providers to coordinate and expedite more effectively. What I see gives me hope. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gruner. So our final presenter, before we have some time for questions and discussion, is Professor Colleen Flood. She's a university professor, holds a university chair here at the University of Ottawa. She came from to the University of Ottawa last year from the University of Toronto. She's the founding director of the Centre for Health, Law, Policy and Ethics here at the University of Ottawa, and very well known in a lot of quarters. And she's going to now share with us some of her observations with regard to principally legal issues, of which I understand there are many, but we're going to get a list of them.
Okay, well, get for something different. Thank you for that tour de force and that very insightful discussion from you and the discussion from you, Doug, about what is happening on the ground in Ottawa. I thought that was incredibly interesting. And has made me reflect on my own thinking on this, my own presentation, so I think you'll probably be correcting some of my slides as we go along. So this is good. I'm learning. So I'm going to talk about some of the legal issues. We're in a law school, so we better do a bit of that. And there are myriad legal issues around swirling around mental health and refugees. How do I advance this, my friend Mario? With this one? Nope. Okay. I have this one? Yeah, okay. So just briefly, we've heard a bit about the risk of mental health issues for refugees and whether they should be portrayed as having high risk or not. The evidence seem to suggest that particularly children, there are high risks of refugees having PTSD. And then once refugees are here, because we don't have a perfect world, there are risks associated with homelessness, lack of education, social supports, unemployment. All of these things put you at higher risk for mental illness. So I think there are a variety of factors that mean that refugees are, as a group, at higher risk of mental illness. And so there are broadly three buckets of legal issues that swirl around refugees and mental illness. The first is the impact of mental illness itself on a refugee determination, so whether or not you will be able to make a claim to be a refugee and how that interacts with mental illness. The second bucket of legal issues are around the immigration process itself, that is, you know, the law impacting on a refugee applicant or a failed refugee applicant and how that may contribute to mental illness or the exacerbation of mental illness. And the final one, which we've heard a little bit about as well, is the rights of refugees to access various social services, and in this case I'm going to talk about briefly about rights to access healthcare, which has been very much in the news over the last year or so. So first of all, the first bucket of legal issues is mental illness as a grounds for accommodation in refugee claims. So the first thing to note, for those of you who are involved with immigration, you will know this inside and out and better than I do, but that mental health issues or mental health illness or disability in and of itself is not a sufficient grounds to apply here to be a refugee. It must be linked to claims of persecution in one form or another. And this can happen in two ways. So the fact of mental illness may be evidence that you have been subjected to persecution in the country of your origin. So the fact of mental illness may be evidence that supports your claim to be a refugee. It may also be tied to the fact of future persecution. So if you're someone that suffers from a mental illness or disability and you can show that in your country of origin, should you be returned there, that you will be subject to future persecution. So, for example, imprisoned because of your mental illness or extreme stigma and these kinds of things because of the cultural or other way that people with mental illnesses are treated in the country of origin. So that is essentially the way that mental illness works as a grounds for accommodation in refugee claims, as a grounds for arguing for to be a refugee. But there's a particular problem for people who are suffering from mental illness or have a disability when they make a claim to be a refugee because of the way that we in law assess the truth of things. I mean, we've had a lot of debate in the media recently about how we assess the truth of things and the ability of witnesses and applicants, for example, in immigration proceedings to be able to portray or convey evidence of their persecution. And this is a particular problem for people who are mentally ill or suffer from a mental disability. So the problem is the issue of credibility. How does one with a mental illness or disability establish their credibility before the refugee tribunal? And they may not come across as truthful because of their mental disability or their mental illness. So, for example, somebody suffering from Alzheimer's might seem all scattered and messed up and saying different things at different times. That may sound, from the perspective of how we normally assess credibility in legal proceedings, to be untruthful. And so this puts applicants suffering from mental illness and disability in a particular bind. And the way that one would normally solve this problem would be for them to bring expert testimony or expert evidence about their mental illness or disability before the tribunal. But there are a variety of problems with this because of the way now that the whole process of determining whether or not one is a refugee has been immensely speeded up as part of the reforms that the Harper Federal Conservative government did. Very quick. It's very quick, the period within which you have to make your application, and then a very short time frame between it could be as little as 30 days before you will have your hearing. And so in that time frame, somehow you've got to negotiate all of these difficulties, find an expert witness, a medical expert, you know, find legal counsel, get all your evidence together, and somehow make this application. It's extremely difficult for people in this situation to do. And then what's more is now that these expert medical evidence that an applicant might bring to bear in those proceedings has, as a result of a recent federal court case, been declared to be largely of little weight, because there isn't sufficient time for the tribunal to be sure that the medical evidence produced isn't essentially biased, right? That it isn't just the kind of gun for hire or too favorably biased towards the applicant. And so the federal court has ruled in a 2013 case that essentially this kind of evidence should be given little weight. So what is somebody in that situation to do? They're really in a bind. The other problem that can come about, which we well know in the Canadian context, is that there is, unfortunately, a very close interaction between people who suffer from mental illness and disability and the criminal justice system. Many people who have mental illnesses and disabilities, particularly since we have moved to deinstitutionalize, moving people out of psychiatric hospitals and ostensibly into the community, but we now just shunt them, often into prisons. So there is a strong interaction. But if you are applying to be a refugee, and if there is any evidence of criminal activity, there is alleged criminal activity, that can be grounds for denying your application to be a refugee. And of course, because of that symbiosis between people who have suffered from mental illness and connectivity with the criminal justice system, they're at higher risk for that kind of declaration. The other bucket of legal issues arises around the immigration processes themselves, and in particular detention and incarceration of refugee applicants, often failed refugee applicants that are going to be returned to their country of origin. Over the last 12 years, there have been 12 deaths by people detained, refugees detained in facilities, basically people committing suicide. This one case of a woman being deported back to Mexico who had alleged domestic violence, who had claimed domestic violence, and she committed suicide inside the Canadian detention cells. But it doesn't seem too much has been done about this. Now, finally, the last bucket of legal issues are around rights of refugees to access mental health care services. Most of you will know about the Interim Federal Health Program. This was a program that had been set up to provide health benefits to refugees. In particular, it included benefits like prescription drugs for treating mental illness, psychotherapy services, and things that aren't actually generally covered under the Canada Health Act. And what happened, as most of you know, is that the Conservative governments under then Prime Minister Harper reformed all of this in a very limited way, so that most refugees would be entitled to a much limited basket of services. And some refugees, in particular failed refugee applicants and refugees from what they considered countries that were, in their words, most likely to have a lot of bogus claimants, such as Mexico and Hungary, would only be entitled to no healthcare coverage except for things like communicable diseases. So things that were of public safety, essentially. So most refugees from these countries would get nothing. Most refugees would get more of a limited basket. And what happened was that a variety of people here, including physicians for refugees and a number of faculty from this law school, but many other law schools, banded together to bring an application to challenge that decision under the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. This challenge was actually successful under Section 12 and Section 15. Section 12 is cruel and unusual punishment. Section 15 is equality rights. So basically the argument was that treating these people from Mexico and Hungary without any kind of inquiry into whether they may have been genuine refugees, the assumption was they're all bogus refugees. And you know, simply refusing to allow or admit of the fact that there may be actually genuine refugees in that group. So the federal court overturned the Harper government's move on the basis of that. That was then appealed. In the interim, the new federal government under Prime Minister Trudeau came to power and has promised to reinstate all of those services that were covered. Now, but I think it is interesting to reflect on this case because of what you raised, Doug, about, you know, let's just look at this. This is what the rationales for the changes that were given. This is one of the conservative MPs, appealing to her base about why we should cut off the refugees from healthcare. And one of the claims they made was fairness, right? Fairness because refugees were getting benefits that the ordinary Canadians, you know, middle-class Canadians, weren't entitled to, such as coverage for prescription drugs, such as coverage for psychotherapy. Now, this portrayal I don't agree with at all because of the fact that many refugees are very low-income and most low-income Canadians are covered in some shape or another for many of these benefits. But it does underscore and in bold and, triple bold, big font, whatever, the fact that we have a terrible healthcare system for everybody in Canada when it comes to mental health services, full stop. Awful. We don't cover prescription drugs. The Canada Health Act does not include prescription drugs. We are the only universal healthcare system in the world that doesn't cover prescription drugs, and somehow that's okay. And we don't cover psychotherapy. No, just don't. It's not covered under the Canada Health Act, and that means for all of us, we have very poor access to mental health care. So I think as Doug said, perhaps the arrival of many new refugees maybe this will help us actually start to, a moment as a fulcrum to kind of lever us to really think about how we provide mental health services, not only to refugees who need it, but to all Canadians. Done. Dusted.
Thanks, Colleen. So we have about 15 or so minutes for some questions or comments. I would suggest, because this is being streamed and also recorded, if you want to ask a question or make a comment, if you would come up here. Unfortunately, we don't have a mic out there. And I would welcome to take two or three right away and then get the responses from the panel. Let me just say one thing before. I neglected to observe that this panel is actually organized in cooperation or collaboration with a number of parts of the university. First of all, of course, the Human Rights Research and Education Center, of which I'm part, but also the Department of Psychiatry, the University of Ottawa Brain, Mind, and Research Institute, the Refugee Hub, and of course, the Center for Health, Law, Policy, and Ethics. And I'd just like to acknowledge and thank them for their contributions in that regard. I was struck, let me just say one thing, I was struck, Colleen, with one of you pointing out that we paid $661 per person, I think, under the IFHP. I noticed yesterday the reporting from New Hampshire that Jeb Bush paid $950 per vote in New Hampshire. So I guess we got our priorities all wrong somewhere. anyhow, that was my small observation. Are there any questions or comments from the floor? Everything was that clear? Dr. Park, did you want to... So the question from Dr. Park is the shift conceptually that I think Professor Papadopoulos was mainly laying out. What is the operational implication of that? And are there any examples that could be cited? Particularly examples where this is being implemented in a positive way.
Yeah, thank you. I suppose I can mention it here, although it's televised or whatever, that I was asked by the Greek Ministry of Health to develop a document, a strategy document, with specific guidelines to address the increased influx that is expected as from the spring in Greece. But that's just one direct comment. The other is, I can say that this grid that I have discussed and presented and discussed with you now has been used quite widely by international organizations, by the International Organization for Migration, by UNHCR, etc., in assessing crisis situations in different parts of the world. In fact, it formed the framework of the psychosocial approach of the UN in Haiti, the grid, first. Then it has been used quite widely in the Middle East with Iraqi refugees, in South Sudan. I just completed a very large scale project in Abkhazia, where this is also included. In effect, the framework is helping us not only zoom into the negative effects of any adversity, but also try to assess the specific strengths of that population, as well as what they have learned from their exposure to that adversity. And if a strategy is developed that includes all three, then obviously it makes more sense. It's a better conceptualization. It doesn't fall within the polarization perspective, and it includes a degree of complexity. It's a kind of almost an enforced introduction of complexity in the way that I was thinking. Not only this, but that as well. It breaks the oversimplification. It breaks the polarization. It is used increasingly in different countries in different ways. Yeah.
Any other questions or comments? If you could come here maybe and just pose it to save time. We'll take both of them in their role.
So I just wanted to bring together a couple of points. So there was this point made that we need to sort of conceptualize these as rights rather than as needs. And I take it that your point about conceptualizing people and not pathologizing the mental states of refugees was to say we shouldn't be searching for people who are in mental health distress necessarily, making that the criteria for admission. But I take it that refugee admissions are kind of an aspirational right for, like, Canada's not going to let in everybody who wants to come in, so we need to be selective. And so it seems that in that light of that selectiveness, as Professor Flood explained, we look for people who, or we allow mental health to be a consideration. Is that something you'd oppose, or do you see that as contributing to the problem you want to remedy, or how do you, just your comments on that?
Yes, that is a tricky situation, of course. That is not only in Canada, in most countries is the same situation, that in order to argue for some sort of evidence for the reason for them to stay in that particular country, you need to cite not only the persecution, but also some form of mental illness in some way. I've been offering some training to asylum judges in the UK and in Greece, and it's interesting that once you begin to educate people of these complexities, they can actually appreciate the subtleties of these situations. Law has is completely clear about certain categories, but also there are a lot of other subtleties within that we can use. And this is what I'm talking about. I'm talking about this creative agility that we can use in understanding these complexities and not just simply going in terms of black and white. So there is some development there. So you're asking me, am I opposed to that? No, of course I'm not opposed to that. And in effect, very clearly, the grid is saying that some negative effects are there. The point is, can we counterbalance those with the totality of the situation that is a little bit more complex than simply they are disabled and they are victims and they are, you know, we need to help them only because of that. We need to help them also because of their human dignity. Also, we should not forget that these people, insofar as they are survivors, and I don't want to play around with the words victims and survivors, insofar as they are here and they have survived something, you know, usually I ask my trainees, ask yourself, because I ask myself in front of them, had I been in their situation, would I have survived in a better way? Would I have survived? So once you ask that question, you also see their strengths. And then you can think about the potential of that person in your country. And the trauma is a very peculiar paradox. It's a very peculiar paradox because on the one hand, it's used to sort of say, have pity on them, and because they are disabled, we need to accept them. But in effect, you are saying also you're going to accept somebody who is disabled in your country, and you are burdening your country with disabled people. And we forget that actually these very people, yes, they may be disoriented, yes, they may be suffering, but also they have a unique dynamism because they have survived all these things. And they are intent to make a new life. Mm. And they're going to help us. And look around, who are the people who made contributions in countries? I mean, there are many lists of eminent refugees. Einstein was mentioned earlier. He is not the only one.
Actually, Canada, the refugee class is higher earnings than the business class immigrants. So.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Thank you.
I had, I guess, a comment and a question for you all. And I guess the first is that I was at an event in Toronto yesterday hosted by the Toronto Central Lynn on refugee mental health. And there was a psychiatrist there who works with the Canadian Centre for Victims of Torture and is often asked to provide diagnoses for refugee claimants. And there is quite a power imbalance, I think, in those interactions. And given, I guess, understanding of Western psychiatric, like Western medicine, it can be quite a colonizing or colonializing experience for refugees themselves. And so she made a point that I thought was really poignant and maybe useful to some of you, is that in her efforts, she says, you know, it's really important for me to help the individual understand that I'm not giving them a diagnosis to tell them that they're sick. I'm trying to help them to understand that what happened to them is sick and that they themselves are, I guess, that I am trying to help them to be able to get the claim so that they can then go on and sort of move forward with their lives. So I thought that was really like an interesting way of framing that for folks. I don't know if that's helpful. But my question for all of you is that, I guess, as policymakers and ministries of health across Canada sort of hurry right now to make their budgets for this fiscal and into next fiscal, and they're looking at ways to address refugee health and mental health, if you had recommendations for them as they go on to do that, what would they be? Like, how do we create a system that is able to provide the kind of adaptive care that you, Dr. Gruner, were talking about, where we can be sort of more flexible and accommodating to folks. Sorry, that's really practical.
Yeah. Well, I guess I can start. The question is an excellent question. So essentially, if I understand it correctly, how can we improve our systems such that not only refugees, but other folks that suffer from mental challenges, mental illness, are able to access our system more effectively? So this has been, as I said in my talk, one of the biggest challenges we've faced for a very, very long time. And one of the things that works really well at Bruyere, for example, which is I would call it a model of care, you know, best practices, is where I work, it's a clinic of about 13 staff physicians, and there's 20 residents. These are family, well, doctors who are becoming family doctors, learning the trade. And within our group, it's a very robust clinic in the sense of allied health professionals. We have dietitians, clinical pharmacists, kinesiologists, you know, we have social workers, and we have what we call the shared mental health team that work right in our clinic. So two psychiatrists, Dr. Green, who works very specifically actually with a lot of my patients who are refugees, and another psychiatrist, Dr. Bob Svensson, along with a psychiatric nurse and two social workers that support that team. We're able to have this connection between the primary care providers who are on the front lines and you know, assessing and, you know, picking up these sort of, you know, issues, and are able to access the specialists in a much more effective way. We need more of that. So we need to kind of see that we have, you know, five or six community health centers. They are looking at Bruyere and thinking, wow, especially in light, again, this crisis has kind of shed light on, you know, the inadequate sort of scenario that we practice. And so the community health centers are looking, well, maybe we should be doing something like that as well. And so if this sort of model of care becomes more of a reality in these family health teams and the family health organizations, then there is a real possibility to ensure better access for the patients that need it. Of course, that comes with resources. So not only do we need human resources, people that actually have the capacity to provide therapy and have the expertise for that. Also, we need people that have the expertise working across cultures, because this country, this beautiful country of ours, is so diverse. And so we need to be able to have, as we've heard, you know, the complexity, the agility within our systems to be able to respond to the multitude of cultural differences and the other challenges that we face with our patient population. So these are some of the ideas that I would like to see funded. And there are sort of, you know, best practices that are taken up, and when they get funding, it just takes off. So that would be my one plug for the ministers.
I'm just going to jump in as well, though, and say that it's not just about funding, but that we actually need to change our governance and legal structures, which can result then in more funding. But our colleague Simon Hatcher and others are working on this concept of a parity of esteem. So why do we treat physical illness so differently from mental illness? And that is reflected in so many ways in our governing laws, in the Canada Health Act, in the framework of funding that the Ontario government and other provinces have. And I think it's time for a cold, hard examination of that, and to really to really test that. So it won't, you know, my argument here is it's not just about refugees, although refugees are maybe the way, you know, help us think about this issue right now. It is actually about everybody and the families of everybody who's ever had anybody who's suffered from mental illness, and the fact that they can't have their, you know, they may, maybe you might be able to get them in at some point to see a psychiatrist, good luck. But if you did get them in, you know, are they able to get their medications? What is the point? You know, and if you want them to be receiving, or they need to be receiving psychotherapy, and only those of us with private insurance benefits are able to actually do that, again, what is the point? The very people that most likely need this are probably not the well-heeled middle class like myself. I'm the one with the private insurance benefits covering it. So that, I think that's what we, the bigger picture thing that we need to do. But, you know, the immediate sort of, I completely agree about the cross-cultural aspect of this and the need for investment in that as well.
Yes, thank you. I strongly endorse what has been said by the two other speakers here. I want to add by commenting on the two points that you raised. The first is about tortured refugees, but not only with tortured refugees. I think the idea, I use it a lot, that when you are talking with them, I do also write reports for failed asylum seekers in the UK. And I may need to use post-traumatic stress disorder argument if that is the case. But then I will work with them. I will not just simply write that, and I will explain that that is something that needs to be addressed in order to strengthen their the argument, etc. Not sort of lying to them or lying to anybody, but putting it in context that that is, yes, that's one part, but there are a lot of other parts, and in a sense trying to counteract the negative effects of the victimizing implications of that label. So we need to be aware that that tendency is there, and we need to counteract it in some way. Mm-hmm. So, and yes, one way of dealing with that is conveying the reality that they are responding in a healthy way, so to speak, to unhealthy circumstances. But if you are talking about a psychiatric disorder, there is an element of unhealthy. There is. Okay. That's the first thing. Secondly, when we're talking about what specifically needs to be done, again, I repeat, I endorse what has been said, but I still would like to add to that, and that is the reconceptualization and our modest way that each one of us can contribute towards moving and altering the refugee discourse from these fear limitations, etc., to something more appropriate to the reality of the situation. Not to move from a blind compassion, from a blind fear to a blind compassion. Let them all eat, give them everything. That's equally unrealistic, idealistic, and inappropriate. But within that reconceptualization, perhaps the issue of resources in terms of psychotherapy and drugs may not be that relevant, because then we're talking about more meaningful community involvement and appreciating the complexity of the situation. So what they need is not just psychotherapy and drugs and counseling and all of these things, but they may need more meaningful community programs to be integrated, to be valued, to be appreciated for their complexity, their difficulties, and their strengths. And that's what I'm interested in. Yes, responding to improve the existing situation, but dare I say, I'm a little bit of a revolutionary. Let's change the existing situation, not in a meaningful and real way. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. We got a few minutes over. I'd like to thank everyone for attending. There's still quite a bit of food there, so if everyone wants to get a bite before going. I'd like to thank our speakers. Give a round of applause for them. for any of you who would wish to stay around, Professor Papadopoulos will be joining us upstairs in the Human Rights Research and Education Center for a cup of coffee if you want to continue the conversation in any way. Also, do let us know if you'd be interested to get the link for eventually we will put...
We'll send it around.
The link will be available through our websites and so forth so that you could see this or share this panel more broadly. Let me thank again our collaborators, the University of Ottawa Brain Mind Research Institute. Dr. Park, thank you for coming. And the Department of Psychiatry, thank you, Valerie. Professor Simon Hatcher, who was mentioned already, unfortunately, is unable to be with us. He's overseas today. The Health Law Policy and Ethics Center, Professor Flood, the Refugee Hub, and the University of Ottawa Human Rights Research and Education Center. Thanks again to everyone. My last word just simply is to say, as we began with rights, let me just end by observing that the first article of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Universal Declaration, when you talk about universal health care and really universal, not geographically, is that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights, and posits the idea of a full life in dignity and freedoms, not just existence, not just physical existence. And I think that might be the spirit, the normative spirit, that could help us reshape the way we deal with these kind of problems. Thank you very much, and have a good afternoon.